Welcome to the Boxing Life podcast with me, Tony Jeffries. On this episode, we're going to be talking about the Canelo and Chavez Jr. fight. Also, it's just been announced, Canelo versus Triple G. Then we're going to talk about why we think everyone should be doing some sort of work for free to be successful. And then we're going to touch on Wim Hof, the Iceman. We're going to talk about him a little bit and meditation. So alongside me, to my left, I've got Glenn, Mr. Six Figure Holmes. Glenn, how's it going, mate?
Good. Excited to get into these topics after that real shit show of a fight last night.
I know. Terrible, wasn't it? And then to my right, I've got Mr. Kevin Watson. Kev, how's it going, mate?
Good, man. Good to be back. How are you?
Good to have you back. Kev's been missing. He's been MIA for a little bit, right? What have you been doing?
Traveling a little bit and, I don't know, just busy working, doing things.
Being busy. Like, we've all been busy. So, the fight last night, you watched it, Kev?
Yes.
You watched it, Glenn?
We watched it, yeah.
We watched it. We went to Brendan Schaub's house and we watched it in there. And what a crap fight.
Yeah, it was disappointing, wasn't it? I think going in, I said to my client in the morning, I don't think it'd be as competitive as people thought it was going to be. I've never really rated Chavez Jr. And I thought that Canelo would have had harder spars than that going into the fight. So I wasn't surprised to see him be comfortable, but the biggest disappointment was just the lack of fight and heart and character from Chavez Jr. He just did not give a shit, and he's been like that for most of his career. So
yeah, I'd agree with that. I think people were hoping for a little more entertainment just because of his size, Chavez's size alone, hoping he could stand there and bang a little bit more, but he didn't look like he had any business being in the ring with Canelo.
Here's what I thought. I don't know what you think about this, but was his offense and his punches taken away from him by Canelo's skill?
Yeah, I think
and
he
judgment
felt,
of range. Or do you think it was just he was so scared to let his hands go that he was just going to get counterpunched every time?
I think in the first round he felt how solid Canelo's punches were, and from that point on,
he didn't want to
let his hands go at all.
And in the first round, he put a bit of pressure on Canelo and pushed him back, and he threw a few punches that got through, and I was like, yeah, oh, this is going to be a great fight.
He did, yeah. He landed some big shots.
And then, I mean, fell to pieces after that. But I'll tell you what, Canelo, that was a punch-perfect performance. He was unbelievable,
yeah,
right?
I think super he could sharp. Have even let his hands go even more. He could have let five and six punch combinations go ease. You see what Lomachenko tweeted? Posted on Instagram. It was so funny. He just posted a clip of Canelo hitting the heavy bag. He went, I saw this last night or something like that.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's kind of what it was like. It was funny what Brendan Schaub tweeted. And he said to us last night, he said, tonight's the night you don't want to fight like a rich kid's son.
And that's exactly what he did.
Like a rich kid, yeah. And that's what he did. He fought like he didn't want to be in there. And I mean, it's easy for us to sit on the sidelines now and see, you should have done this, you should have done that. When you're in there with a beast like that and you're getting pounded with them punches, I just think because we've got a lot of expectation from him because of who his dad was, a Mexican warrior. So we were kind of expecting the same when he's getting these, coming back with the counters, and he wasn't doing it.
The highlight of his career's bit was the Andy Lee win. But I think that was he just outsized him. He was huge in that fight. But other than that, I've never really thought he's been as big as what people make him out to be.
When you told me he boxed Andy Lee, I thought, wow, I never knew that until last night.
Yeah,
I thought, now he's definitely got a chance. Cause I boxed Andy Lee in the amateurs. He beat me by, I think, 2 points. And Andy Lee was the only person, I've only ever got dropped once in my life, and it was by Andy Lee in a sparring session when I was like 17. He hit us with a right hook and dropped us. So I was like, wow. And then he beat Andy Lee, so I was surprised with that.
Yeah.
So I thought, this is going to be a good fight, but we've never really seen it.
Yeah, I think for Chavez, it's just he's not skilled or dynamic enough of a fighter to not have heart. It just doesn't show that he has a lot of heart and a lot of. I think that
he showed it in the Sergio Martinez fight when he came back in the 12th round and dropped him in that, because he was getting schooled for 11 rounds and he came back and dropped him in the 12th. So there's something in there, but I just don't know why he doesn't perform. It's weird. I just don't think he gives a shit. I think he's got enough money. I just don't think he has the desire to.
Well, that's what we were kind of waiting for. We were waiting for that, thinking, oh, well, he's not doing anything for the first 11 rounds.
Yeah.
Lost every single round. Maybe by the 12th round, he was going to
maybe he was
step him up.
Yeah.
But he didn't do it.
Yeah, but I think credit to Canelo for why he was, because he didn't allow him, did he? As soon as he...
Yeah.
There was a slow-mo on Instagram yesterday of Chavez Jr. throwing a jab, and Canelo just slips it perfect, smashes him with the right hand.
I remember that fight. So what now for Chavez?
I don't know.
He's done.
I don't see much.
He was done before the fight. Yeah.
He's like 31 years old. He's had 54 fights.
Fights. Yeah. Yeah.
But his dad had like, well, how many dad have? His dad had
80,
like
over 80.
I think it was right around there.
He wasn't undefeated for like 80 odd fights.
60, I think.
And then was it Delahoye who broke that, right? His dad. I think his dad Delahoye definitely sure beat Chavez Senior.
Right.
But like now, is he going to retire? We think he should. I'm sure you do as well, right? You think he should retire?
I mean, I don't think he wants to be a journeyman. I mean, I don't see him wanting to do that for anybody. So
I think he can still be a tough opponent for a bunch of people coming through at middleweight. I wouldn't mind seeing him fight Lemieux. I think that'd be a decent fight. There's fights out there, but as far as him being a headline pay-per-view fighter, that's done.
I want to see Lemieux Canelo fight, even maybe before the Triple G fight, even though it's not going to happen. Yeah, but I would love to see that fight.
Yeah,
yeah. We were talking about that last night. We kind of thought that's the fight that they're going to go for next because he was on the undercard. But then it wouldn't really make that much sense for Canelo to fight him because Triple G's already beat him.
Yeah, it makes no sense. But it's just what I would love to see.
The chances of him making 160 are impossible now too. We saw, let's see how good he was at once, or Chavez Jr. at 164.
Oh, yeah.
I think
if he's going to do anything, he's got to go back up to like light heavyweight, maybe even
or super middleweight.
Yeah,
I think there'd be some good fights for him there at super middleweight. There's a bunch of good opponents around, and then
definitely
people will want to make a statement against him and try and stop him because Canelo couldn't stop him.
Yeah,
you know, like we've got like Chris Eubank Jr. Billy Joe Saunders. That would be a great fight. Be a decent scalp for Chris Eubank as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, I think he should retire, but with his background, his pedigree, with his dad having all them fights and all that, and him having all them fights, I just don't think he will. And I don't think if he did, he's got what else is he going to do?
He's always going to attract interest, even though we know it's going to bring, he's going to let people down, but. Just there's always going to be a fighter there. It's going to be like, oh, maybe he could push them, maybe he could test them. So, you know what I mean? He's always going to raise questions, but
sure.
I think him being a main event fighter, you know, top of the card, he's done.
And because of his name, I think that they'll want to have them fights
exactly, with
him. And he's durable, so people want to prove the point, so promoters will want to do that.
So on to Canelo then. What did you think of the way they announced the Triple G fight?
Go on, Kev.
I mean, I hated it. I get why they do it, but it seemed a little too artificial, a little too WWE for me.
I know you're a fan, but... As soon as it started, I was like, they've just been watching Monday Night Raw, and they're like, let's go for it.
Well, what I think it is also, I think it's totally disrespectful to the other fighter, Chavez, who's there. It's just like...
He just disappears.
Yeah, did they do that in a UFC fight recently or something? But I just see it so much disrespect towards the other fighter, and even towards Canelo because it's his you know, he just won
it's
the fight.
His pay-per-view, right?
And so, but I mean, that's what people want to see though too. So,
but clearly you must have been all right with it because it was all
sure.
Yeah, well, just think now how big that fight, how much it makes that fight bigger now. I mean, it didn't need that, but now it's like he got in the ring room, he squared off, they've announced it now. I mean, like you see, it's took the shine off him winning that fight.
Yeah.
But because now the headline's not about him winning that fight, the headlines are about him fighting Triple G.
Exactly.
You know? But with that, I liked it. It was cheesy, you know, I'm not one who likes cheese, but I was like, it's different, you know? It's like they're trying something new. They're trying.
Yeah.
Like when, I don't know if you were thinking about the fight with, it was when you said it happened with the UFC, it happened with boxing with Anthony Joshua when he beat someone.
He beat Eric Molina.
Was Klitschko that got in the ring?
And then Klitschko was ringside.
Like straight away.
As
if the promoters knew, like, he's going to beat him. And
It was your boy, the guy from Sky. What's he called? He was in the ring. Andy Scott. He was in the ring, and he went to Eddie Hearn and said, Eddie, do you have anything you want to say? And then he announced the date for the fight. So it was all prearranged as well.
Sure.
So I think we might see a little bit more of this in boxing moving forward.
Yeah.
I think it's a smart way of doing it because clearly they're competing with UFC for that entertainment value and trying to build the big fights. There's not that many big fights out there. Triple G, Canelo's one of them.
Yeah.
And then apart from that, they're struggling to sell pay-per-view buys. You know, the Andre Ward Kovalev fight didn't do very well. They're going to struggle to sell the second fight. So I think they're just trying out this kind of, if this fight goes, how we plan it going, we've already made an arrangement for the next fight. Let's put that announcement on this card.
But how would you feel if you're Canelo and you just went through 12 rounds and all of a sudden the fight's over and above on the big screen is just
like bigging up Triple G.
Just intro of just Triple G with this real intense music.
It's weird.
Wouldn't that make you feel like shit? Like,
That's what Brendan was saying. Like, what the hell? Like,
I would
like,
fucking
like,
hate
let's
it.
Celebrate Canelo.
You'd hate it, but
he must have knew before.
Exactly.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
They've said to him, "Here's what we're gonna do." He probably just be, okay, fine, yeah. Whatever sells the fight.
And then Canelo just showed Triple G zero respect when they were in the ring after that. Yeah, that?
Triple G looks so uncomfortable too coming out. Like, he came out to his normal ring entrance song. He looks so uncomfortable. So uncomfortable.
He's so funny because he's such a nice guy, and all he. Where his tone of voice and his accent, and all he really knows is nice words.
Yeah,
you know, he probably didn't understand what Canelo said after him about
big drama show.
You know, I said this last night under my breath, but the way he speaks reminds me a lot of the way Donald Trump speaks, because they did some study at some point on Donald Trump, and like his reading level based on the words that he uses is like third or fourth grade level. And that's what it feels like when Triple G's talking. I'm like, oh my God.
I mean, like, I just think as soon as I hear him speak, I just feel like I'm watching Borat.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just Borat.
I think every American feels that way because that's all Americans know.
Such a nice guy, though. Triple G training in this gym where we are right now in Boxing Burn, Santa Monica. That was probably 2 years ago. He was training for a fight against that Australian.
For the Daniel Gill fight.
Yeah, and he come in the gym. Such a nice guy.
That fight before that fight, too. In the
gym. They both trained there, like separate times. And Triple G was. Great getting pictures with everyone and talking to everyone as best as he could.
Yeah. That was amazing. I was up right here on that corner when he was doing the shadow boxing in here.
Yeah.
I watched him shadow box for like 5 or 6 rounds.
Yeah.
I've never seen anybody cover that much distance.
I think we all were saying the
same
thing.
In one or two steps.
Right.
It was insane. Sick. He was from like the center of the ring to the corner in just like one step. Just like, just like covered so much ground. It was insane. His footwork and feet were ridiculous.
Yeah, and like I always say about the boxers, the higher level of boxers, the better the footwork is. It all starts with the feet in boxing. And if you even look at the likes of Mike Tyson, no one gives Mike Tyson credit for his footwork, but his footwork was phenomenal.
Mm-hmm.
How he could change them angles.
Cut the ring down.
And get his feet in, shift his feet in place to get them power punches off. They were amazing. Footwork in boxing and MMA as well.
Yeah.
All them top guys.
Oh, definitely.
I think Triple G's a little his footwork's amazing. He's a little bit different, though. He's so well grounded. He's not bouncy. He's not like not a lot of
it's steps
movement.
It's
it's real steps like wide. You know? He's always grounded. Yeah. Always got a strong base, and that's why he gets those massive shots off.
Right.
Him. Yeah. But another one, like you saw great footwork, and his distance is just perfect. And when you talk about Triple G when he come and train in here, I mean, it was class. How good was that for boxing burn, though? Because when he trained in here, there was 100 media people here taking pictures, videos.
HBO people and all sorts. I mean, all the boxing people in LA. It was great.
And then every time you're seeing, like, because when a superstar like that, or like Conor McGregor, comes and trains in the gym and he posts a picture, or there wasn't media here for Conor McGregor, but that Spawn thing went viral. It just goes everywhere on all our social media feeds. And you just see the Boxing Burn logo in the background.
Yeah, it's amazing. So good. I remember there was a video of, I think it was you, Kev, posted a video on the Boxing Burn Instagram. And it had like a couple of thousand views. And then the next day, McGregor posted that he was in Brentwood.
Yeah.
And tagged the gym or whatever. Thanks for the hospitality. And then that video that you posted, Kev, when it was like the next day, was at like 11,000 views. We got like 10,000 views on the video in like 2 days.
I think it was even more than that. The one, Kev, shadowboxing, right?
Ridiculous.
Which one was it?
It was when you were shadowboxing. It was in this ring here when Connor tagged the gym and stuff.
You're talking about the one that was next to his video.
So I mean, that sort of stuff, if you've got a business, try and get Conor McGregor in your gym and try and get a post word. I mean, it's not easy, but I mean, we got like 2,000 new followers on Instagram because he posted this one post. You know what that makes us think when celebrities or someone, I mean, Conor's probably the biggest athlete superstar in the world right now. Would you agree? I mean, the one below him, I would say, who would you say?
I'd say Anthony Joshua.
Overall
In the fight game.
Athlete.
Maybe Ronaldo.
Yeah.
LeBron. But LeBron's huge, but I don't think he's really globally, like, likable. People don't love him as much as...
Yeah, I don't think, where are we from, LeBron's that big.
Yeah, I mean, basketball's just not big in England, period.
But I would have said Ronaldo. Ronaldo's big in America now, right?
Yeah, I mean...
I think Messi's bigger here than Ronaldo.
Really?
Is.
Yeah. Wasn't Ronaldo's side piece Kim Kardashian? Someone told us before that he used to fly her to Spain private just so he could bang her and then fly her back. Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Imagine if you've got that sort of pull. Imagine if you're that guy. Well, I've heard he's got a tool on him as well. I have.
Have you seen the documentary on him? Speaking of Ronaldo, have you seen the documentary on him? he's not. It makes him look like a complete asshole, right? Mm-hmm. He's watching a football game with his kid, and his kid's on the couch with him, and he says to him, like, when you become a professional footballer, what position are you going to be? And his kid goes, goalkeeper. And he goes, no, you're not. He's like, that's the ridiculous answer. He's like, just scolds him, like, hammers him, saying goalkeepers are worthless. Like, they're nothing. You're not going to be a goalkeeper like this. Yeah. Just, like, so controlled. And that kid, I think he's, like, his adopted kid, right? Didn't he adopt a kid or something?
Yeah, I think...
I don't know, it's just a weird
story. Ronaldo's a legend, though. Like, outside as well.
From the people that... like Jamie Reynolds has been working with him, and he can't speak highly enough of him. You know, people say nice things about him and talk about how professional he is and how hard he works.
And what he's
done. In that documentary, it comes off like he loves
him. But what he's done for charity and all that, and he adopts kids, and you know, he paid for someone's heart surgery, which is often
amazing.
Something like that. I mean, what a guy he is. There's a video of him on YouTube I've seen before where it says how many times Ronaldo gets. If he goes for a coffee, how many times he gets asked for a picture? So there's hidden cameras around this cafe, and he's sitting outside and he orders a cup of coffee. Before the cup of coffee comes, he's sitting there just normal. He gets asked for like 15 pictures, and he's just sitting there talking to his friend, and people just come up asking for pictures. And it's just
that'd be annoying, wouldn't it?
Oh, it'd be terrible.
It would be, because I mean, you can't go anywhere. But what's the alternative? Not. I would rather flying Kim Kardashian over. you know. I mean, it's worth it for that. But what a study is. What was talking about is if getting these high profile people in the gym. I mean, it's massive. It's not easy, but it's really good for the brand and all that.
This is what I love about this podcast. We started off talking about Triple G and Canelo, and we ended up talking about flying Kim Kardashian to Spain.
Just a banger,
just a banger, just and fly her back, yeah.
people who were listening and they said, when I said at the beginning about in the intro about working for free and why everyone should be working for free, let's talk a little bit about that. So you've just given us a cue on that about Andy Scott. You remind us that. So Andy Scott, I don't know if I told you this, he done that little documentary thing I showed you on me when I finished from the Olympics. He contacted like 15 Olympians after the Olympics when he was in university and asked them if he would come up and do a little interview with them. And none of them replied, apart from me. And he drove up to Manchester when I was training in Joe Gallagher's gym, and he done an interview with me. And I said to him, do you want to do some more stuff? And, you know, what you got in mind? I said, let's do like a bit longer, do like a little day in the life thing. He said, all right. And he was so keen, a young little student. Mm. So he started videoing me, following us around Sunderland, done an eight part documentary.
That was the Life as a Pro one.
Tony Jeffrey's Life as a Pro. It's on YouTube. Check it out. And then since he's put that out, and then Frank Maloney, my promoter, was like, oh, I need someone.
Kelly
now, yeah, right. Kelly Maloney. he, whatever you want to call him, he said to him, let's start working for me and start videoing more of me fighters. So he did that, and Frank Maloney was in with Sky Sports. Ed Robinson, you know, Ed Robinson works for Sky Sports, seeing his work, and he's like, wow, this kid's real good. Anyway, fast forward, however many, 5 years, Andy Scott was the guy who was in the ring in the Anthony Joshua fight, Klitschko fight, interviewing them after the
smashed it.
Yeah, after the fight. So talking about working for free, what he done there, he worked for free. Mm-hmm. I never paid him to come and do that.
That's an amazing story, that.
Yeah. It is.
And he's like he's like top boy.
He's a top boy.
He's guy at boxing now.
He's done like Triple G and all of them who fights on Sky. He's the guy in the ring and now he's interviewing them. So working for free, that's one example of it. Another example of it is, I want to say the podcast, like podcasting for free. That can be great as well. So,
a couple of the boxing burn trainers have started their own podcast now as well.
And I tell everyone to start your own podcast. Why not? You know, why not? You're not going to get paid for it.
Right.
So, but still, it's getting your brand out there. And Ernie, the producer, wants to hire more, wants more people, right, Ernie? Yeah,
I think it's just a great outlet to talk about whatever you're passionate about, whatever you love. Start a podcast, talk about it, and then eventually, if the more you do it, you can get to a point where you can start getting paid for it, and it's going to open some doors.
Well, I think the key word is passion, because if your passion is money, then you're not going to.
Right.
Sure, some people might be successful and might make some money, but you hear it all the time. You have to do what you're passionate about, and then you'll be successful. Yeah. Success is not determined by how much money you want to earn. It's determined by how passionate you are about what you do.
Yeah.
It also reminds me of a quote. I think we talked about it maybe in a workshop one time. It's the man who does or is paid much less for the amount of work he does will soon be the man that is paid a lot more for I can't get it right.
No, that was right. But that was right. Yeah.
Is paid a lot more than what he does eventually. I guess whatever.
So what that means is do more than you're getting paid for,
yeah.
And you'll eventually get paid more than you're doing.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. That's exactly.
Like we've had trainers in Box and Burn who come in, like Josh Hackford, who's going to be on the podcast soon, and Josh Pollard, who was on a previous podcast, Kerry. We've had, and even Glenn sitting here, we've had trainers who come in and they work extra hard, do more than they're getting paid for, mm-hmm. and in the end it pays off, because now yeah. Glenn's doing bot all and he's getting paid a fortune.
Did you just say I do nothing?
He does nothing.
I look at my schedule.
No, but I mean, and that comes down to passion, right? So we get trainers in who's really passionate, and they'll be in here all day. They'll be working with clients for kind of free on the bags, just showing someone who's not wanting personal training, they'll show them how to throw a correct right hand, or if it's in the weight room, they'll show them how to squat correctly or correct the form.
Just going above and beyond.
Above and beyond, yeah. And from that, then we'll be like, the clients or the people might be like, oh, how much is it for a private training session with you?
Yeah.
Next thing, they've sold a 10-pack for a grand, and you know.
And that's that, like we always say to in our workshops and our training meetings, that it's not just applicable to what we do. It's in every walk of life, no matter what you do. If you go above and beyond, people notice that, and it's going to come back to you.
Yeah.
Like Glenn spends so much time on his Instagram. If you look at Glenn's Instagram, at Glenn Holmes LA, right?
Yeah.
And look how fancy that is. He's not getting paid for that, but it will pay off. How will it pay off? Because now if someone goes on Glenn's profile and they see how he's got it all organized and it's all... got loads of information on how we can improve them with his blogs and all that on the Instagram, it's going to be like, wow, if I want to train, I'm going to work with Glenn because look how smart his Instagram is.
You know? It's interesting you just mentioned that actually, because do you know Ben Bruno, the trainer Ben Bruno, he just texted me somebody there, someone who lives over this side that wanted to train with him and he couldn't do it, so he referred him to me, and she contacted me, and then the first thing in my response was, if you need more information about me, here's my website, here's my Instagram, everything you need is right there. So it's like, I've put all the effort into the website and the Instagram and the blogs, are you saying, are there and all that. So I'm like, I can't wait for people to go and see that stuff. Right. You know what I mean? Rather than waiting for them to approach you and say, oh, where can I find out more about it? Oh, well, I don't really have, I've got a video here, I've got a video there. You know what I mean? It's just like, boom, here's my website, here's my Instagram. Mm-hmm. And then anything you need to find out about me is like, or view videos, any of that kind of stuff. Something.
So you weren't paid for that, but it just, what it does eventually is increases your exposure and opportunities for success. And then eventually you're going to see some return on that monetarily or, you know, whatever it is, but you'll see returns. Just it increases that exposure that something good's going to come your way.
Yeah.
That is just one example of how you can, how are you working for free? Because it is work. I know you put a lot of work into that.
Yeah,
it's like these YouTubers who's famous now and they've got tons and tons of hits and views. Like Philip DeFranco was one. I don't know if you know who he is. I watch him all the time. He's got a news channel. He started off just like all the rest of them because they were passionate about it, like you say, Kevin, about the passion and not wanting to make any money. But now they're making millions because they've started this channel for free.
I think just to go back to the your mindset, it's interesting what Steve Krebs, one of our guests on a previous podcast that's in the archives, if anyone wants to check it out, he was on a couple of weeks ago. He was saying, I think you posted this clip on your Instagram as well,
when
he talks about your mindset and attitude to money determines everything else. So you start chasing money. It's how you view money determines how you do everything else. So if he said, I view money as peace of mind, security for my family, and comfort,
right?
That's how I view money. And that's exactly how I view money as well. I'm not interested in having, you know, billions and billion excess and all that. I mean, obviously that'd be nice, but first and foremost, it's about having that security and that comfort.
Right.
So then everything else you do on top of that, you're likely to do it with more passion because you're just trying to get to that comfort in terms of money, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, so then the rest you're just going to do for passion because you love doing it.
Well, it's like what Biggie says, the more money you come across, more problems you get. And that's I think that's true.
And then just on the Instagram thing, the way I look at Instagram is I see it as a website. So it's like people go straight on your profile. I view that as like the modern day website, really.
Yes. Yeah.
So that's why I try and put so much effort into how it looks and what's on there and think about it a lot. A lot of people don't really think about it that much and they just kind of throw generic stuff out.
Right,
and
yeah.
Oh, they don't put that much thought and effort into it.
Yeah.
No one wants to see what you're eating.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Well, we've got the Instagram stories for
I saved that for the story, yeah.
Yeah. Or the cup of coffee.
Yes. So the quote I was trying to pull from memory is, if you are willing to do more than you are paid to do, eventually you will be paid to do more than you do. I just think that's it's simple, but it's very powerful and it's very true.
Yeah.
The internships are that. Like in an internship, you go in and you bust your ass, you don't get paid, but eventually you're going to get, if you do well and you work for a good company or work under a good company or have a good mentor, they're going to see to it that you have good opportunities once you're finished with that.
It's having a good eye for opportunity too.
What's that?
Having a good eye for opportunity is key.
Oh yeah, yeah.
That's like a skill in itself.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people get given opportunities and they don't have the skill set to see it as an opportunity.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, oh, they're asking me to work for free. Or I'm not going to go to that. Or whatever.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, it's a mindset. You got to flip your mindset.
Totally.
You got to see what the benefits of it are. And if you don't, then either you're in the wrong field, you're in the wrong industry, or you're just.
I think you've got to kind of like a long-term vision,
yeah.
You know, and setting long-term goals
as well,
and things like that.
What all of this is really good for, when we're talking kind of more about the social media here, is for SEO, search engine optimization, which is how powerful your name is on Google. Because if I want to look for a trainer for my kids, let's say it's Glen Ohms, first thing I want to do before I let my little girls train with anyone, I'm going to Google Glen Ohms.
Yeah.
And then if I come across your Instagram and it's the way it is, I'm definitely train with Glen. That's right. But if I've got pictures, if you're posting pictures of you drinking out trying to tap up girls and all
that,
are you working with my kids?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, that's the search engine optimization. So, I mean, that's another story about being professional on your Instagram. But being everywhere, there's a podcast by a guy called Pat Flynn. It's called about being everywhere, being on blogs, having your own website, being on Twitter, being on...
What's that podcast called?
It's Pat Flynn. Passive Income Podcast. He's a person who tells people how to start podcasts by yourself. He's someone who, when you Google how do I start a podcast, his video will come up, Pat Flynn's video, and he'll tell you what equipment to buy and how to start and what software you should use and all that. So if you're interested in starting a podcast, Google Pat Flynn, how to start a podcast, and I really think you should start a podcast, because you're not going to get paid for it, but you're there for people to find you, especially if you're in this industry. You're there for people to find you. If you're not on Twitter, get on Twitter. Even if you're just sharing your links from Instagram, just get on there, because it's good for SEO. It's really, I mean, you know how good it is for SEO as well, right?
Yeah, it's huge.
Google
yeah.
Plus
Definitely.
Is another one. Then obviously Facebook, and have a Facebook page for your business as well. I mean, I'm going to do a podcast all day on social media and marketing. But yeah, I mean, be everywhere and work for free. Work for free. I mean, I thought that makes sense, right? It is kind of working for free.
Yeah. I think another route you can go with that is also thinking about philanthropy work and doing, and just that stuff you don't get paid for, but you're giving back to the community. And not only is it maybe good for your business or good for your name or your brand, but it gives back and it makes you feel good about yourself and it's making you perform better and do better, I think. That's another way you can look at it too.
And doing events like that is great for networking, because you don't know who you're going to meet as well. Mm-hmm. So you're being everywhere with that.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, definitely. It's unbelievable how good it makes you feel when you do stuff you don't have to do.
Right.
I gave some woman on the street a bottle of water the other day.
Yeah.
She had a sign on like Lincoln and Washington, just like anything will help. And usually I'm not that
That's
generous. Yeah. I'm usually like. You know, but I had a bottle of water on the floor in my car, and I just leaned over and gave it to her, and she was just like the happiest, pretty, like made her day. Like, she's face just lit up, and then I drove off, and then I was just like, I felt amazing.
Last week, I was walking down Santa Monica Boulevard, and there was a big food truck there, and there was a homeless man just looking at all the food, and I was like, I'm going to buy him something. So I was feeling good. Yo, mate, what do you want? So I ordered him whatever it was, and they come at like $12. I was like, oh, shit. Right? And then I paid the $12, and then I went, all right, mate, and I was walking. We went, excuse me, this is the homeless man. Excuse me, can I get a can of Coke as well?
Yeah.
So it was another one. I was like, all right. So it was another $150.
No shame at all.
But yeah, I mean, I was with Sarah and she was like, oh, that was kind of, and I was, like you said, I left there feeling great.
Yeah.
You know?
Definitely.
So another way to feel great, move on to the next topic, Wim Hof. Have you heard of him, Kev?
Yes. Yeah.
Wim Hof. And yeah. I heard of him through Aubrey Marcus, had him at his house the other week, and same. The Iceman, where, and I was like, who is this guy? And he's got like 12 Guinness Book World Records for doing crazy shit in ice. Yeah. He was the only man ever to walk, I think the only man, or the fastest man, I think the only man ever to walk Mount Everest in just a pair of shorts.
Ridiculous.
What the fuck's that about? So Wim Hof, I think he's about, I'm seeing 60 years old, 55 years old. His wife died when he was, I think about 20 years ago. He raised his 4 kids by himself. He was depressed all the time, so he needed something to do. So something told him to get in ice bath or whatever. Anyway, he's figured out the Wim Hof method. It's kind of like ice bathing, but it's more about breathing. I think it's kind of like a form of meditation. Anyway, next week he's doing a seminar in Los Angeles, and I'm going to go there and see what it's all about.
You love your ice baths, don't you?
I mean, I hate them.
When you were fighting, you used them a lot. Right?
Yeah, I feel like ice baths is the best form of recovery. Like you see these cryotherapy,
yeah,
where you're standing and it's minus 300 or whatever it is.
That's like the soft man's version.
It really is. Because
I love it because I'm in there for 2 minutes instead of sitting in an ice bath for 15 minutes. Yeah, I can't do it.
You don't get the same results, I'm telling you. But so Wim Hof, he does these breathing exercises, which is mad, right? So I've been looking into them before I do this course that I'm going on. And he says, I can make you hold your breath for 2 minutes. And I'm like, not a chance, mate. Not a chance. So I'm watching YouTube videos, and the way he does it, you've got to, I'll do it now, you've got to breathe in and then let out a little bit. So you breathe fully in and then just let out like normal.
Yeah.
Like this. You've got to do it. I think it was like 50 times. It was like a week ago. I don't know. And I'm going lightheaded on the sofa. I'm going lightheaded on that. And then the last one, you breathe in. And you hold it.
Yeah.
Oh, no, you breathe out. And then you hold it when it's out. And then you time it.
So you've created like an oxygen reserve.
Exactly.
And then you can hold it.
Yeah.
That's
so
amazing.
So now that your blood and your brain's got all this oxygen in that it needs. And then I timed it. I held my breath for 1 minute, 55 seconds.
Right.
And I could not believe it. 1 minute, 55 seconds.
So my experience, I first heard about him maybe 2 or 3 years ago. He was on, Ben Greenfield was talking about him a lot on his podcast.
Right.
Great podcast, by the way, the Ben Greenfield podcast. Anyone into fitness, wellness, all that stuff. And he mentioned him a little bit, and I looked into him. And it just, at the time, it just seemed a little bit like woo-woo, like all this like crazy breathing stuff. And I didn't really get into it. But since then, he's exploded. His popularity is unbelievable. Mm-hmm. And then just speaking of what you said with your experience, trying to breathe in, the other morning or a couple of weeks ago, I was driving up to Malibu to train somebody up there. You know, those really like rough, depressing mornings I have up in Malibu.
Yeah.
So I was driving up there and I hadn't had time to get coffee yet. And I was driving up there and I was like really tired. It was like early morning. I'm like, shit, I'm not going to have a chance to get coffee. So I quickly searched YouTube for Wim Hof, like energy breathing or whatever. And I put it on and it was like a guided Wim Hof breathing technique for energy,
right,
to get energy quick. And it was just the same sort of thing. It was like nasal breathing, like really fast. And I did it for about 2 minutes while I was driving.
Right? I wish I would have pulled up next to you.
I'm like, right.
What are you doing?
Fuck this guy. Shit. So,
tell the truth, that's what you were doing.
So then, but just my experience from it, I was like, I got there and I started like getting ready for the session. I was flying. Just like blood flow through my body like crazy. It was unbelievable. Like heart rate was up and I just felt warm and like energized just from 2 minutes of that.
He said kind of with the method of breathing, you can survive. Well, you can get in these ice cold baths and all that with feeling good. So that's what I'm really interested in doing, because ice baths, even for me who've experienced them, it's a nightmare for us to get in one.
You know? You get in, but then when you get out, you feel great.
I think it's amazing.
Have you done them?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, of course.
The plunge pools are great too, going from hot to cold. That's the best. Yeah. You get that tingle feeling, and you feel like the inflammation just getting out of your body. Yeah. I'm interested to see how much he talks about mental power and mental strength at that conference.
I think that's a huge component of it.
I think it's huge, yeah. That's it's mind over matter a lot of the time, right, with that stuff. You know, like standing in ice for a year on top of Everest.
Right. Well, he talks about how this breathing method helps with depression.
Yeah.
You know, so, and that's mental, isn't it? So, yeah, I'm very interested in going. And I've never really, it was like $200 in it. I just thought, I'm going to do it because it's going to be an experience. There's something I've never experienced before.
Just to get nerdy for a second, the science behind the breathing, it takes you from your sympathetic nervous system to your parasympathetic nervous system. I think I've got that the right way around. So your sympathetic nervous system is like your fight or flight, which you're in most of the time during the day, right? And then your parasympathetic nervous system, Josh could probably confirm or deny, is this right, Mr. Degree Man over there? And then your parasympathetic nervous system is when you're sleeping and resting and recovering, right? When you're calm and at ease. And it's proven that the breathing techniques take you from your sympathetic nervous system to parasympathetic nervous system. So it puts you in that mental state of relaxed calm.
If you're able to get past that first 30 seconds. Yeah.
This is golden nuggets right here.
Yeah, I mean, if I can't spell the word that you're saying, it's like Chinese to me.
All right.
So what I've been trying to do, I've spoken about it before on the podcast because I'm having a year off drinking. This was me, New Year's resolution, because I struggled so much with switching off from work. The last thing I think about at night, the first thing I think about in the morning is work and trying to, I don't know if it's a creative mind or what, just trying to think of different ideas. I'll be watching the telly, a commercial will come on the TV and I'd be like, how can we do that for Box and Burn? You know, I'm just constantly thinking about stuff like that. So I can't switch off. And me big thing was wine. That's how I used to switch off last year, and I put loads of weight on. So with these podcasts, when we done the one with the mind pump people, we did it when me and Kev went to San Jose, and then they came in. They can't recommend meditation high enough. And then Steve Krebs, another one, can't recommend meditation high enough. So I got the app Headspace. Mm-hmm. You know Headspace.
Sure.
And I've been trying to do it. It's like 10 minutes for 10 days in a row. You put it on your phone and you listen to this fella speaking. He's an English fella. And you're trying to switch your mind off, which is really hard. I don't know if you've tried it before.
I haven't. No, I went over to their headquarters for that thing they did with Maria Shriver, which I was really impressed. It's pretty remarkable company, but I haven't done it yet.
Have you tried? You've tried meditation.
I do sleep meditations. I've done a couple of breath work meditations. They make you feel amazing, put your head right. But I'd recommend people starting with sleep meditations because that's when you're getting ready to kind of wind down anyway. So you're more likely to concentrate on the breathing and what's being said to you. They start with a guided sleep meditation. I have so much success and results with them. I just can't last past 5 minutes. I'm just knocked out.
Well, see, the best time to meditate is in the morning before you get up and you do stuff. So, I try that. But with the being on my phone, like, I think 9 times out of 10, I'll be meditating. I'll pick my phone up and there'll be like 6 texts. I'm like reading them. So it's just like, it's went from this to boom, work mode. So
can you put on airplane mode or no? It will work?
Maybe. I'll have to try that next time.
Yeah, on airplane mode, yeah.
And, but another big thing that I've been doing, which is really helping, is like keeping off my phone until I'm ready to work. Like if it's 11 o'clock, if I want to spend the morning with the kids, not even touching my phone until then.
Yeah.
Because I think that's the hardest way to switch. The reason why we can't switch off so much is because of this device that we've got.
Definitely.
And it's like non-stop all the time.
That's why meditation is on the rise. Like what the mind pump guy said, why it's sort of skyrocketing now is because everything's so instant and distracting. Mm-hmm. The rise of this, okay, take a minute to get yourself like back to where you need to be. Yeah. Is, you know, everything's going fast and instant, and it's like the rise of the counterbalance of that.
What Ryan Munsey said, who was on a podcast, was he was talking about how much information that the human body can take in now. And he said, I think it was in 1975, the average human took in, I cannot remember the numbers, but I'm going to make them up.
I remember him saying that on the podcast.
It was like 8 newspapers worth of information with like 30 page newspapers. That was in 1975. Today, it's something like 200 news spikes, something ridiculous. Yeah.
So information is so readily available on your phone. I mean, you have access to everything.
And that's what he said it was through.
Yeah.
Like through your phone, because every time you look at your phone and you've got notifications and you've got a million people posting a million things and you're trying to read them and all that, you're taking all this information in, which 99% of it's shite, really, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely.
It's shit, but it's that habit of your phone. Mm-hmm. So sure. I think that's a big thing for me to try and switch off, just keep off that thing.
It's having the discipline to use your phone for your benefit too.
Yeah.
Right.
Use the phone, don't let the phone use you, if that makes sense.
No, it does, definitely does.
So we're doing, before we wrap up, are we going to do predictions for the Canelo Triple G fight?
Yes, let's do it. So, go on, Kev.
Oh, wow, I got to go first?
Yeah,
I haven't thought about this yet.
Swan copy.
Well, I mean, are we picking rounds or are we just picking winner?
Whatever you want.
I'm going to say Triple G. I don't know. I think it could go 12. I think it's possible it could, because I don't know. We'll have to see how much they mix it up. Triple G, you saw, got a little bit fatigued in that last fight. He's also shown that he can get hit, and Canelo can certainly hit. So I think, I don't know. We'll see. I think I'll say 12. I'll go 12. Triple G
points.
Yeah.
I think it's an unbelievable fight. It's the best fight that can be made. I think Triple G wins. I think maybe, I'd say points too. I can't really see Canelo being stopped. He's never even been troubled, has he, really, in 40-something fights. So it's just a case of who's going to have the best chin, really. Yeah. I think they're just going to go at it. It's going to be a great fight. I can't
Canelo
wait to
can
see.
Get hit too. I mean, Floyd did, but that's Floyd's an exception. Triple G is not Floyd, but
right.
I frustrated him.
I think it's like you said, it's going to be the best fight in the fight that I'd rather see than any other fight in the world.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I want to as well pick Triple G, but I would like to think he would stop him, but it's hard to think of Canelo getting stopped. He's that good. Canelo's that good. And I've always said Triple G, but after Canelo's performance last night as well,
And Triple G's performance against Jacobs, although Jacobs is tough and he's big.
Yeah, right. But the thing with Jacobs is it's a complete different style. He was an elusive southpaw on his back foot,
true.
Where Canelo is going to come straight forward and come straight
into
these punches.
Right there. Yeah.
It's going to be a great fight, and I'm going to give two predictions. My number one prediction is Triple G on points. On my number two prediction is Canelo to stop him.
Really?
I think he could actually stop him, because I think Triple G can get hit, and he likes to get hit, and I think he's going to be surprised by Canelo's power.
The best stoppage or knockdown?
Stoppage.
I think he might stop. Yeah,
that's knock him down and stop him. Yeah.
It's like what I said before, the Klitschko-Joshua fight. Any of all possibilities could happen.
Yeah.
Both could win by knockout, both could win by points. I mean, that's always the case, but everyone's got equal chance of happening, I think.
Yeah, or it could be a spooky draw to get the rematch.
Oof.
You never know.
When Triple G fought Kell Brook, when Kell Brook had his best work against him, he was stood in front of him, letting combinations go, landing uppercuts, threes and fours, boom, and he was landing at will. And then once he started trying to move, that's when Triple G cut the ring down and started catching him. So Canelo's going to stand in front of him. He's got a wide variety of punches. He can throw uppercuts, body shots. He doubles up punches. Yeah. You know, he's going to land on Triple G. Yeah.
I mean, Lemieux hit Triple G a few times too. I mean, by the end of the fight, obviously, Lemieux had taken quite a bit of a beating, but I mean,
Triple G's jab in that fight was ridiculous.
Yeah,
how well he established the jab.
Yeah, I think
you
have to do the same with Canelo as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. It's going to be a good one.
Well, thank you for listening to the Boxing Life podcast. And thank you to British Vintage Boxing for this T-shirt, for sending us a T-shirt. And they sent all the boys one. If you want to send us T-shirts, you can send us T-shirts to your company and we'll wear them on the podcast to Boxing Burn in Santa Monica. Make sure you follow us on Instagram at Boxing Life. And also, Glenn is doing that special offer of when we get to 50 reviews on iTunes, he's going to give someone a free one-on-one training session in Boxing Burn Santa Monica. And Ernie's agreed to pay for your flight and accommodation if you're coming from England. And let Steve Krebs, the guy who was on last week's podcast, the business coach, said he'll give you a 30-minute consultation telling you how to improve your business for free as well. So that's worth a couple of grand. So
keep those reviews
coming. This is the person that's the 50th review or one of those 50?
No. Yeah, there was some confusion. Someone contacted me.
Who, your mate, right?
Confusing,
your daft mate contacted you. It's easy.
Once we hit 50 reviews out of all those 50 people, we're going to select one person.
How are you going to pick it? Just random?
At random, yeah.
Okay. No, I think we picked the best review. The best review, like whatever's
the most
best.
Entertaining review then. All right, we'll go with, instead of doing it at random, we'll do the most entertaining review.
All the best. We'll get a few and then we'll pick. Okay. All right. So thank you for listening. Until next time, we'll see you later.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks.